am Kathy Elsesser. I am the global chair of the consumer retail and healthcare businesses in the investment banking division. And I am thrilled to be joined by the founders of Allbirds. Before we start, raise your hand if you've heard of Allbirds before. You feeling good, guys? You feel better?
Good awareness.
Keep your hands up. Leave your hand up if you own a pair of Allbirds. If you need any help, they're right here. Okay, that's impressive. That's awesome.
That's better.
You like
better
that?
Conversion than our website.
You think?
Yeah.
Okay, so Tim is a former professional soccer player, for those of you who did not know that, from New Zealand. And he joined forces with Joey, who is a biotech engineer, and they officially launched Allbirds in 2016. Since the launch, it is a certified B Corp startup, which we'll talk a bit about, but that's all about sustainability for those of you who don't know. They've sold millions of shoes. They've added many additional products and product lines and have done some unique launches both on Earth Day and with some other retailers and other brands. Simple, sustainable, comfortable, and most importantly, cool. Welcome, Tim and Joey.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
So Tim, starting with you, you grew up in New Zealand,
mm-hmm.
became a soccer player.
Mm-hmm.
You were named to New Zealand's World Cup team
mm-hmm.
in 2010. Why did you decide to retire from the game? And in addition to that, how did your soccer career maybe play into this professional entrepreneurial career you have today?
Sure, yeah. Thanks for having us. It's great to be here. Great to see such a big turnout. In a previous life, I played soccer for a living. I played professionally in the A-League and for New Zealand and was fortunate enough to go to the World Cup in 2010 in South Africa, which is the second time New Zealand had ever qualified for the World Cup. So it was a big moment and a cool thing to be a part of. Particularly with the most recent World Cup so fresh in our memories, it was a really special sort of tournament. And I knew that my soccer career was never going to get any better, so I decided to retire and went off to business school. And it was a moment, you know, this business, the first idea for this business started when I was playing sport. I think sometimes these things happen when you have time. I had time when I played sport in the afternoons, and it really was a reaction to a footwear category that I felt was over-designed, over-logoed, overdone, and there was an opportunity for something simple. It was a key part of the reason why I played sport was to get free gear, and I used to get lots of it, and it drove me to go further and further, and everything had a logo, and it changed all the time, seemingly for no reason. So I thought there was an opportunity for something very, very simple in footwear. And I set out to try and do it with no experience in footwear, not realizing how hard it would be. And I found a footwear factory online, visited it in my off season, and started selling this product to my teammates, very much as a sort of a curiosity project more than anything else.
I'm sure they thought that was a great idea at the time.
No, I mean, as you can imagine, it was brutal feedback. But it probably unlocked the second thing. Going into my first ever footwear factory, you realize this is a category that hasn't changed for 100 years, incredibly old-fashioned, reliance on low-cost manufacturing and really synthetics and leathers, so not very nice materials. So it was a clear sort of initial insight that there was an opportunity for using different types of materials in footwear, ultimately a new business model that we got to a little bit later. But it was just... You know, I think what I've subsequently come to realize, was our innovation alarm went off when we asked really simple questions and didn't get good answers. And I remember the first time I was in a footwear factory and started asking sort of really basic stuff, and people would sort of say, you know, kind of sit down, little boy. This is the way it's always been done. And that was kind of, you know, I think that was the fuel to kind of go find solutions to some of the clear problems that I was seeing.
So if we roll the clock back a bit, so, Joey, tell us about when you met Tim, because here we have ex-soccer player, decides he's going to go after Nike and the likes by making a shoe company. You're a successful biotech engineer. Like, how did you find a meeting of the minds? I understand your wives, by the way, introduced you, which I find
they did have a very significant role to play. So they were, his now wife, then girlfriend, was my wife's roommate. In college.
I thought you were going to say, just stop with my wife, which was going to make it very interesting.
I have to be careful when I say those words, just because like pronouns can get tied and things can get, ugly.
And it's really important.
Yeah, it is important. So I knew Tim right when he met his girlfriend, Lindsay, now wife. and became good social friends, but never really had the vision to do business together. And while he was doing this work on the side, selling shoes to his teammates and just dabbling, I think it was really like bordering business, but hobby, kind of on that threshold. He launched a Kickstarter, which I was an early customer of. He sent me a pair of women's 10 instead of men's 10, so I was one of his early complaints from customer service. And I think after a little bit of time, he ended up, his wife suggested that he call me after kind of struggling for a little bit on the fulfillment manufacturing side. And you know, it just so happened that I was at a point in my life where I'd spent 6 years at a company called Solazyme. You guys led our IPO as the lead left book runner. And we'd taken it public. I joined in 2009. We took it public in 2011 with the promise that we could push amazingly renewable and sustainable materials into the world. And we used biotechnology and engineered microalgae to metabolize sugar products and make high performance products like chemicals, which I ran. And I had this just recurring nightmare of a meeting. Every time I'd get advanced discussions in business development with customers or potential customers, it would devolve into this sourcing conversation of, can you just do what we do now and just do it cheaper? And it was always like every single time, it was like, you guys are missing the big picture here. Like the consumers do want this, and this is a better product. You just need to connect it in a way. And sometimes it took going to senior leadership, but in a time when oil prices are low, substitute products are cheap, fast, and easy, people aren't paying attention as much, the brands kind of get soft and lazy. I think this was a really interesting time for me to kind of connect with Tim. So his wife suggested we talked. We talked. I convinced him to fly out from London to my house just north of San Francisco, Mill Valley. And I cooked him a lamb stew that night when he arrived, which he thought was funny. So that was a good start to the partnership for some wool shoes. And then we spent like 3 days really walking around the hills just north of San Francisco talking about why the world needed a new shoe company and if it really made sense from a financial perspective, but also from 10 years down the line when money is no longer an issue at all because we were so wildly successful on the business side, do we really care about this? And that was where the kind of sustainability aspect from my background and I think Tim's intuitive sense and from where he grew up in New Zealand, we really connected on and we felt like we could do something that was worth the 10, 20 years we might spend doing this, or even 3 to 4 years when we're in our mid-30s. And so we just grew a ton of conviction around that. And pretty quickly thereafter, I've heard Tim say this before, but sometimes the hardest decisions are the fastest ones that you don't overthink. And I'd been doing diligence on like 3 other businesses to join or start and just toiled over every one. And this was kind of like, this feels like we could do something special.
So you're walking around the hills of San Francisco talking about a shoe company, and then you decide to get into business together. Mm-hmm. What, and Tim, maybe I'll ask you, what from your perspective was the hardest part? I mean, was it funding? Was it finding talent? What was it that
I think the hardest, beginning was hard? The hardest thing, I'd come out of this career, for me personally, I don't want to speak for Joe, but I'd come out of this career in sport that, you know, I'd unlocked this incredible amount of meaning in playing for my country. It had just had been something that was sort of, was huge for me. And then I found myself in my first real job, you know, post-business school, making shoes, and I didn't really know why. And my old man, my dad used to call me a cobbler, and he used to annoy me because I was like, I didn't grow up on a sheep farm. I didn't have a particular affinity for shoes, and I find myself kind of making them, kind of wondering why. And I think the best thing about that meeting was it unlocked our why and the sense that it wasn't about shoes, although that's what we were making. It wasn't about wool. This was about a kind of a new era in sustainable manufacturing, and there was a real opportunity based largely on Joey's experience to really impact that with a consumer brand that made it a non-negotiable and that we could build a company to tell our grandkids about. And I think you can kind of make fun of these moments because they can become cliched, but for me, it at that moment, it didn't get any easier. We went to go raise money. We can talk about that, all the structural things we needed to do. But, you know, certainly personally, it unlocked the reason why we were doing it. And from that moment on, I personally haven't looked back. And I know it's, you know, for both of us, we felt like we were building something that was worthwhile.
Where did you guys come up with the name Allbirds?
You know, we were, it's kind of a simple answer, but it always takes a little while to get there. But we were just asking around, we were kind of brainstorming different ways, and we'd asked another Kiwi, a guy from New Zealand, who, we asked him, like, you know, what are some trees, what are some birds? He's like, well, there's all birds. Like, and like, what do you mean? When man first settled in New Zealand, there was all birds and no mammals, because it was such an isolated island. And we just loved, we loved it for the reason that it nods back to the heritage, it nods back to a time when people hadn't screwed things up too much yet. And you know, if you take care of birds, you kind of take care of the environment, because they tend to go to the places that matter most. So we liked it.
So I came back to my wife, who doesn't like birds, and I said, I think we got the name. And I was like, all birds. She was like, okay, so you're gonna make, wool runners is gonna be our first product. So you're gonna make shoes made out of wool that are not for running, named after birds that have nothing to do with the brand. She's like, that makes zero sense. And I was like, this is perfect.
She was less diplomatic than that.
Let's go do it. So it's been perfect for us.
So talk a little bit about that. You mentioned when you first had the shoe company and you'd go into these factories and nothing had changed. You guys are clearly going against an enormous industry and you're going against the grain.
Mm-hmm.
What were the hardest challenges that you all faced in convincing people or pushing your vision forward?
I mean, first of all, I think making shoes is incredibly hard. It's an engineering project. I think kind of anyone can make a t-shirt. Making a shoe encompasses all sorts of human factors. We were trying to learn, you know, how to do that with a material that had never been used, at least initially in wool, before. So there was enormous challenges, and that took some time. Years, in fact. So, I mean, if we track that back, I think the beginnings of the idea were sort of circa 2009. Met Joey when he was a disgruntled early Kickstarter customer in 2014, and there was hundreds of prototypes working out how to do that. And I look back at what I was, how we kind of kept going, and it's sort of crazy to me to reflect on. But it was all about solving this particular product problem. So that I think was the largest challenge. And then, I mean, I'm sure you've got other
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, no, I just maybe to go a little deeper on that. It's you have a hard piece of durable item on the bottom of a shoe, and you're connecting it to a soft upper. And we came with a wool material when we first started that had never been used. So we have to develop test standards. We got to convince a factory to go out on a limb and take our first PO, which was relatively small for the shoe industry, and take a leap of faith with us and know that we had no idea what was going to happen on the back of that, because we mm-hmm. chose this direct-to-consumer model. So convincing someone in an industry that hadn't seen a direct-to-consumer shoe company ever scale up beyond $50 million and do it with a material that had never been used is something that's kind of a novel twist for a lot of the supply chain that we were working with. And that didn't come easy. That was the wool mill. It was the sourcing, it was the standards body that we used to make sure that the wool is harvested humanely. Same thing with these tree products we're all wearing. These are all FSC certified. So going through step by step in the supply chain to make sure we do it right, so that when we launch, we can actually stand behind the promises that we deliver. And doing that in an incredibly fast paced timeline. So, I mean, just to fast forward where we were, after a dinner of lamb stew, I quit my job, Tim quit his job in July. We raised money in August, the seed round, found out we didn't have a factory anymore in September, so had to scramble to get a factory. You're cutting metal to make molds for the bottom of the shoes. There's long time testing. Usually, shoe companies take 18 months absolute bare minimum for product development to go from paper through to launch on a shelf, and that would be a really fast execution for a shoe company. So we're doing this, and we launched in 7 months in March of 2016. So really, really fast-paced timeline, shrinking and condensing all that and adding these layered challenges is just something that required a very flexible and tolerant partner. And so we've gone deep. So fortunately, we made 10,000 pair order was our first PO we made with them, followed quickly by 5,000 just for backup. And now we employ probably close to 400 people out there. They're an exclusive factory for us. And they employ a huge ecosystem in Busan, Korea, where we have our tier one factory. And it's been a special partnership that I think we couldn't have made it without.
And so why wool? Why eucalyptus? Sustainability obviously is something you live and breathe. How did those elements factor into your whole vision?
Yeah, sure. I mean, it was about fabric performance and it was about comfort. Wool has these miraculous qualities, which weighs moisture, regulates temperature. And you know, the insight was that it was an opportunity to make a better product, a better performing product, a more comfortable product. I think what we were seeing sort of from a top macro trend point of view, I think there was this fundamental shift going on in the way that people were working and playing. It's sometimes called athleisure, which is suggestive, I think, of a trend, and I think it's something far more fundamental than that. And it had come to apparel, it hadn't come to footwear. And so, you know, when you're no longer working 9 to 5, you're wanting these products to do different things, and wool is kind of the ultimate performance fabric. So the idea that it hadn't been used in footwear before seemed like one of those obvious things that had been missed. Asked the simple question why it hadn't been done, didn't get a good answer, so set out to try and work out how to do that. And the reason why it hadn't is because there was a whole textile engineering process, and this took years and all the things that you don't know. But ultimately was the core innovation behind our first product that we launched on the 1st of March 2016, the Wool Runner. And we've subsequently followed that up with our second material made out of eucalyptus, FSC certified eucalyptus from South Africa, and that's another big moment. People don't buy sustainability, they buy great products, but in this particular case, there was this wonderful overlap where the most sustainable materials were also making the most comfortable products. So it was kind of, that was the North Star for the brand for us, and we haven't deviated from that since the beginning.
And do you have R&D folks that sort of came up with eucalyptus? And I don't think many people connect eucalyptus to shoes.
Yeah, we have, I mean, our second executive that we hired was, we call him a VP of Innovation and Sustainability. So one of the things that I think is a little bit different is that we don't have like corporate social responsibility in our company. We embed it throughout the entire company. So it's actually core to where we are. So we put this guy and we put him in the product team. And so we basically make it a non-negotiable that our products have to be incredibly sustainable. And that then limits what we can look at, the materials we can look at, the processes we look at to manufacture. And that actually unlocks an amazing amount of creativity. And so we hired that really early. And not only him plus his team, which is reasonably small for the kind of work that they're doing, but there is an entire industry out there that is hungry to sell products like I used to be selling products into brands like us, hopefully bigger ones, but we'd be sitting there and no one cared. And so there's all these materials out there that everyone's overlooking because really what they're looking for is faster and cheaper. And so they'll overlook sustainability because there's a stigma associated with that, that it's either lower quality, more expensive, or something bad. And I think hopefully we can be at the leading edge of this, but I think the opportunity is huge, and we see a ton of opportunity in shoes to extend in and outside of shoes using that same principle.
So another big principle in addition to the sustainability is you chose to be a direct-to-consumer business, first mm-hmm. and foremost. We see that more and more mm-hmm. as internet shopping has become much more mainstream than it was 5, even 6 years ago. What do you guys see as some of the benefits of that, and how do you use that direct-to-consumer relationship to inform where the company might go?
I think the direct-to-consumer story has been told often, and there's a bunch of advantages. Obviously, you know, the ability to invest truly in sustainable materials to pay up for, you know, the right things has been helpful for us, and the business model allows it. I think probably the biggest feature for us is the feedback loop. We launched with one shoe, which is traditionally not how you launch a footwear brand. And we were able to then get feedback on the fly all the time. And our customer service team has sat almost right next to our design team from the beginning. We've made famously something like 27 changes to the initial product that we first launched based on feedback on the tongue was rubbing or rolling over. And we're able to roll that into sort of on the fly changes. And it's different from the rest of the industry that's particularly in footwear, that's predominantly selling through wholesale, it just goes so much slower. So we've been able to use to move faster because of that feedback. And I think that feedback has then led to insights on other products that we should make. I think, to give you an example, we realized that about the data was telling us about half of the people that wore our initial product were wearing it without socks. And then when it got hot in the summer, that number jumped to 2/3. And the feedback was that, it was a suboptimal experience when it got really hot. So eucalyptus has a natural cooling quality. We went out on a whole journey to find out what this material was to solve this particular problem that our consumers were sort of putting on our plate. And we did it with this new fiber and then launched a whole new range of, a whole new family of product using eucalyptus, all because we were listening. So we pointed the entire business to listen, and I think it's a significant advantage for us.
And $95, always $95, at least the adult size, and no sales.
Yeah, you can't get away with that if you're not direct to consumer also. So I think that's an important element for us. Like, we try to do a lot more with a lot fewer SKUs or styles. And so if you have that approach, how pissed would you be if you were a customer and we launched an orange shoe and you really wanted that orange shoe and you bought it at $95 and then 10 days later it was like on sale for 20%. And it happens every single time with every style of shoe that exists in the world. And that's not a contract that we want to make with our customer. Our contract is, yeah, we might improve the product over time, and you got to trust that we're always working to make it better. So you're getting the best we have, but we at least won't discount it, and we won't cut you off to the knees, and you don't have to worry about getting a better deal somewhere else. So I think that element, given our strategy of focusing on true material innovation, that just takes a long time. I mean, just that eucalyptus fiber we were working on for 2 years, we're gonna announce another one soon that we've been working on for 3 years. So it's something that is like literally before we even started.
Stay tuned.
Yeah. So
you just mentioned orange shoes. So look, you do special editions. You do something for Earth Day. You did a partnership with Shake Shack. How do you guys make those decisions? Is that part of the feedback loop from the direct to consumer model? Is that just a way to create more buzz? How do you think about that?
Look, it's been about learning. Quite honestly, I think, we've been really disciplined in who we've partnered with. We've barely done it at all, and it's been opportunistic when we felt like we could learn something. And I think the notable example is Olivia Kim, who's the former creative director at a brand called Opening Ceremony, who works now for Nordstrom, and we did a small capsule collection with her because I think from the beginning we haven't considered ourselves a fashion brand. We have a design style component, and this was someone deeply embedded with deep respect in the fashion industry that we could learn from. So we worked with her, and it was awesome. And she pushed and pulled the brand into a different way that we weren't used to, and I think it was a great thing to do. But for the most part, Shake Shack was another example of a brand that we'd all loved. There was the opportunity to do a small thing with them here in New York, and it blew up. It was immensely successful in Danny Meyer's story, their use of ingredients. It felt like they were aligned in terms of how they were approaching things. So we did that quite quickly, and it was great. But for the most part, I think one of the things we have been one of the features of our success is we've said no to 99% of the opportunities that have come across our across our desk. We've been really, really focused on doing a couple of things really, really well.
So let's talk about the company you've built. How would you begin to describe the culture at Allbirds? And is it, my sense is there's not a lot of ex-big shoe company executives working with you.
Right.
So how do you harness all of this energy and creativity?
Yeah, I mean, I think Tim alluded to this idea of the innovation alarm. So you can only ask simple questions if you actually don't know the answer, and we knew very few answers when we started this thing and are just slowly coming up the curve. So I think we really value that. So we tend to look for people who are really smart and very humble, and what comes out of that humility is this idea of a great and deep curiosity, and not just like superficial ask a question to like chit chat. It's like, okay, then go deep and keep going. So I think that's a key screen for us. But one of the things that we did really early on, which was an incredibly motivating activity, and we still, I think it's one of the smartest things we've done. We were like 10 people. It was the summer of 2016, so we'd been in business for like 3 months. And we sat down and we had everyone do what we call the hot pen activity. And this was an activity that was done in this Jewish deli in Ann Arbor, Michigan called Zwillinger. And we had everyone write for 20 minutes, they could not lift up the pen, and they had to say what the future looked like, or I should say, what the past looked like from the seat of 2026 in the summer. Looking back over the last 10 years, what happened? And we took the best nuggets from everyone in that group, and we unearthed what we think is kind of the guidepost for our values as a company, and that comes with being very intentional, and I think this is a good example of being intentional, being curious and simplifying naturally, we call it, and streamlining processes. And so those values came out of that, and then this 3-page vision document, which is really a strategy document of what we saw transpired over the next 10 years is written in prose. It's really detailed. It's specific enough to be valuable, but abstract enough to last a few years, because we're obviously going to get some things wrong back in summer of 2016. And we still to this day give it to every single finalist that comes in for an interview. They read it before they come in for the final rounds of interviews. And it excites people to no end, or it repulses them aggressively. And so we like quickly weed out people that are not gonna be a good fit for the culture. And we excite people and motivate people who feel like they could fit into that and are inspired by that vision. And then when they get there and they start, they hit the ground running way more quickly than I've seen before in other companies. So their effectiveness, you know, your traditional like executive effectiveness takes 18 months. I don't know who said that, but people say that. And that would be way too long for us. So we have to shortcut that. So it's like, how do you connect to what we need to do? Where are we going and how can you help? And so that you can then understand those little, that the bigger vision and then the micro decisions, which when you add up all the micro decisions, it changes your trajectory wildly, can make you, send you into a good place. I think that's, I'd say those kinds of activities are the ones that we've created. And then we do small things to make sure that people remain humble and reminded of that and have different experiences. We sit at reception, we both work in retail.
So talk about that. People move around their jobs, or they have time where they spend time doing other people's jobs. How do you affect that? What do you think the outcome is that?
Oh, not so much other people's jobs. It's just this was actually an idea we'd taken from a brand called Method. Eric Ryan, a great guy who's been a real inspiration for us in different ways. And they had this revolving reception. And so we've just taken it. We have everyone work there. You end up getting more work done there than you do at your own desk. And it's just been one of the little sticky things that shape a culture, and they're weird and they're wonderful, and we've tried not to be too programmatic about it, but let it happen in the right way. But the working in retail is something that we do once a month, and we jump on the customer service phones as well, and we encourage the whole team to do it when things are really busy. And again, it's amazing what you learn. I think you can be caught in the clouds of a business strategy, and there's nothing better than actually fitting someone with a pair of shoes to understand the business that you're in and what the type of experience you need to anchor everything around. So some of these rituals we've found have become really powerful, and it's important as we scale from kind of two people and Joey's dog Walt to now a team of 130 odd in San Francisco and growing really fast.
And we don't have to hire a receptionist, which saves money.
Yes, totally.
And as you think about that culture, how, now that you are getting big, how do you continue to generate? Do you do the hot pen exercise again? Do you do it with fewer people? How do you continue to keep people motivated as you've become bigger so that their voice is heard, but at the same time it becomes impractical at some point to have everyone suggesting ideas?
I don't think there's a simple answer for that, except to say that it's important. If you prioritize it, if you make it one of the key things that you think about strategically, one of the key risk factors, if you get it wrong, then that's the best start. It's really interesting that the culture thing is not an easy thing to do. It's an easy thing to talk about. It's a harder thing to get right. And we just thought deeply about it and tried to sort of celebrate all the little things that make up a culture, all the little behaviors that you want people to repeat when you're not in the room as this thing scales. So focusing on those little behaviors with a view that they add up to the big things is kind of how we've approached it. And working on reception when the head head of operations is there to kind of meet the take the FedEx deliveries in. There's a certain sort of humility that I think spreads across an organization when you're thinking in that way, and that's sort of how we've tried to approach it.
And as companies scale, getting the resources in is obviously critical. Ultimately, not everyone fits. And if you're really trying to build a sustainable business and a sustainable culture, how do you handle those situations?
That's tough.
Oh, great. Thanks.
Over to you, Joey.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you guys how you divide up responsibilities, and it's becoming
whoever
clear.
Whoever speaks first directs the worst ones. So we do it humanely, but we do it quickly. And I think we had to do it really early, once or twice, and we've had to do it a number of times since. And I think we talk about the company, and I don't think this is any rocket science or novel thinking, but we think about the company much more like a sports team than a family, and we try to communicate that this is it's a place that you have to be incredibly satisfied to work, and the culture has to be good. But the culture doesn't mean that it's like nice and soft and easy. It means that you're with people who you respect and you have admiration and trust for, and so you love to come to work because you're spitballing with people who you respect, and you just have a great time when you're there. But part of that requires you to execute and perform, and we have pretty robust systems in place for how small and young of a company we are, in terms of managing to outcomes. We use a system of OKRs, I'm sure you guys are familiar with, where we have kind of a set of key company priorities, and we roll that down. We talk about them really regularly. We try to make them memorable so people actually remember them, and there's mnemonic devices so that people actually get them. And if it's not, if the performance is lacking, it becomes quite visible quite quickly. So no one's generally too surprised, and if they are, then obviously we take that as a failure of ourselves. So we just try to make sure people know where they are and have a culture of direct feedback with lots of trust. And I think, we're getting better. It's always hard to do it.
It sucks. It's hard. Yeah. I mean, at the end of the day, it's hard. And if it's not hard, you're probably not doing it right.
Yeah, or caring enough.
Well, it is also hard to be a CEO. Mm-hmm. It's incrementally harder to be a CEO of an entrepreneurial, fast-growing consumer products company. How is it being a co-CEO? How did that come to pass? How do you guys divide up responsibilities? Take us into that world a little bit.
I think, for us it was kind of like a semantics thing. We didn't really overthink it too much, because we knew that if this partnership was gonna work, it didn't frankly matter who was called what. But that we had to have a deep trust for each other's skill sets, and particularly the ones that were not much overlap. And I think Tim comes with an incredibly intuitive mind for the consumer, from a brand marketing perspective and connection with that consumer, an unbelievable ability to create products that people didn't know they wanted. And so I feel like I can be really helpful in those areas, but I try to be helpful. And Tim can be the natural leader there, and I think I don't know if equally, but similarly at least, he would say the same thing about kind of the areas of focus that I've had in terms of administration of the business and operations and supply chain, some aspects of technology where I feel like I can I've spent a long time in materials and things like that, where I can add more value. So we kind of just naturally divide that up. And then there was this like really pragmatic reason, which is like when you start a company, every investor wants to talk to the CEO. So instead of like one calling the COO and then they're like, oh, well, can I just talk to the CEO? You're like, well, we're just co-CEOs, so just talk to me. And then we're in the media and stuff like that. They want to talk to the CEO. So having two just like it enables us to do more.
The ultimate in divide and conquer.
Yeah.
Yeah, it totally is. I mean, having, in the early days done this by myself, I'm both as a co-founder and now as a co-CI, I mean, I think we're doing more together than we could individually. And, I think it's worked really well for us, and I couldn't imagine it doing it any other way. And he translates for me, too, because no one can understand me a lot of times in meetings. So he'll go, what he actually was trying to say.
And how do you guys, you have a board. How do you interact with the board? What value do you see the board as bringing to you all and to the company? How does that manifest itself?
Yeah, we have a small board and we've kept it small. We have a broader set of advisors. So I think there's, we think about the places, like I'm a like a network learner, I would call it. Like I ask the same question, if I have no idea what I'm doing, I'll ask the same question to the 10 smartest people I know in that area and then filter it out and figure out what to do from there. And I think we do that as a business, and we have a board that plays a really fantastic role for us to kind of step back. We do it quarterly. We put information together that we think is valuable for the business and don't do anything redundant for the board, really. We also use it as an opportunity where Tim and I co-write a letter to the board. So every board meeting, the most valuable time that we have is and I encourage anyone to do this who has a board and finds themselves in a similar situation. We write a letter, which is kind of our innermost thoughts for the quarter. And we write it down, and then we spend an hour to an hour and a half with our board in a closed session, and we go through what's on our mind, and we generally get incredibly rich dialogue coming out of that discussion. And probably most importantly is the writing process makes Tim and I exceptionally aligned around what we need to do, what we've been doing, and what we've been doing well and not well, and what we could do better and should do better in the future. And that writing process has been great. So that's a nice step back, but I would say we get tons of amazing advice and feedback, and use resources like our employees in particular, the executives, but all the way down to retail staff and people in our factories where we get ideas from. So we kind of look pretty broadly.
And today you define yourself as a footwear company. Can you see that expanding into a broader brand umbrella over time?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think the idea from the beginning is that it was larger than that. And that being said, we've been incredibly focused on footwear, and it's an enormous market, and we've got a lot to learn and a lot more problems to solve, I think, in that category. But, you know, look, from a high level, I mean, I think, you look at organic food, I think, is a great case study. You know, so not that long ago, you thought organic food, you assumed it was more expensive, it had dirt on it, and it didn't taste so good. And we've seen a mainstreaming of that particular category, and I think the same thing's about to happen to fashion. Outside of the fossil fuel industry, it's the largest emitter of carbon into the atmosphere, so there's a real problem there. And we believe that we're on the kind of a cusp of a new era of sustainable manufacturing, and we'd like to think that, you know, brands like ours can be part of solving some of these problems. So the idea underpinning this is much larger, and I think we've set this thing up, to be broader than that, and we'll see where it takes us.
And as you saw, the majority of people in this room not only know you but own your brand. You've obviously also, I'm sure, caught the attention of some major multinational and very large competitors. How does that dynamic work? At some point, they perhaps weren't taking you seriously. I assume now they're taking you incredibly seriously. You see them, are they trying to knock you off, or what are the dynamics there?
Yeah, I mean, there's been a bunch of reactions from the industry. I wouldn't give them too much credit because they're pretty slow, so that's good.
They know too much.
Yeah, there's probably like 15 to 20 ripoffs, like direct knockoffs of our product already, and we've dealt with that and with various tactics as we go. But we've never for a moment thought that making a wool textile or making a wool shoe or making even a wool shoe and a eucalyptus shoe was going to be enough to allow us to have a competitive moat that would be sustainable over time. And we set out to do something that was reasonably long-term and quite challenging. And so we knew that we needed to make investments in R&D and innovation really early. And we knew that if we created little competitive moats along the way, that the consumer that loved us and particularly the ones who saw us early and from the beginning would start to appreciate that we're delivering something fresh and new all the time. And that would allow us to maintain something that was truly sustainable from a competitive perspective. And so the consumer will never get tired of innovation. And so if we keep delivering, we make new boxes, we make new shoes, we make things out of different materials that we're working on that are not in shoes. And I think we start to cobble together a story that can be loved over time and can be really respected and generate a lot of loyalty. So that's been the plan from the beginning. So we try not to think too much about what's happening in the industry and just stay laser focused on what we set out to do.
Well, one thing we can't ignore, and we hear this a lot more so 12 to 18 months ago, that retail is dead. There will never be another retail store. All retail is going away, all over CNBC, and you guys are opening up retail stores. Where does retail fit into your direct consumer model, and how do you make the decision around those stores?
Yeah, I mean, direct to consumer, you know, honestly, when we started, we said, okay, we're making comfortable products and we're a material science company. That's how we kind of thought. We don't talk about ourselves all the way like that a lot, but if you're making a tactile product that is supposed to be comfortable, you have to feel it. So we knew brick and mortar would be central to our strategy. And we don't differentiate direct to consumer. It can be offline and it can be online. And we think if we create an amazing experience in a geography that we know we have a bunch of consumers who will like us, it's going to work. And it's going to not only, and our friends at Warby have shown this and talked about it quite a lot, where when you put a brick and mortar store in a region and the brick and mortar store does well and you have a lot of people walking by, your e-commerce business does much, much better. And so the synergies between these two in increased brand awareness, the ability to try it on for people who just don't like to shop online. And we still only have 17% of shoes in America are transacted online of the 2.5 billion that are bought and sold every year. And so people clearly still like to buy shoes in a store. And just because Amazon and other e-commerce players have made it more convenient, it's not necessarily the best experience for everyone. So we don't wanna go crazy with stores. We're not doing like 2,000 stores in the US or anywhere close to that. But I think there's a significant role for brick and mortar to play, as long as we have the right, pun not intended, footwear footprint for our stores, and keep it small and keep it in places where we know that our consumers will love us. And then we're also expanding pretty aggressively on the international front. And each country is different in the way that you have to think about brick and mortar and e-commerce. And there's a lot of nuances as it pertains to e-commerce in China, where you can't do what you do in the United States from a DTC perspective. And there's different nuances in the UK and Germany. And so we're kind of trying to take a regional approach and go into every market in a methodical way that makes the most sense for that region.
Let's do a quick lightning round. If you weren't wearing Allbirds, Joey, what would you be wearing?
Well, we both have a rule. It's no Allbirds at only weddings and funerals. And and outside of that, basically, I've never, in the last 3 years, worn something else.
So bare feet.
Yeah.
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay. Tim, celebrity you were most pumped to see wearing your shoes?
You know, early on, we had Al Bundy from Married with Children, which was it was a pretty cool one. But probably personally, I had a... my parents, so New Zealand's got a new prime minister. She's 37. She just had a baby in office.
We've noticed.
Yeah, and she's a fan of the product. When she first met the Australian prime minister, which is a big deal in New Zealand, she gave him a gift of Allbirds, and he already had a pair. And that was one of those moments where you thought, okay, we're bringing nations together.
World peace. Work on world peace.
World peace. This is going okay.
Favorite podcast.
Favorite podcast. I'm kind of old school with that. I like Radiolab.
Me too. Favorite podcast?
The How I Built This. Can't go wrong with those ones.
Can't go wrong. Last book you read?
I'll give a personal plug. It's Sadie Shaves the Day. And that was published by Allbirds. It's a children's book that comes with our Small Birds product. If we sold it on Amazon, I'm sure it would be a bestseller, but they don't get our data.
Who wrote that?
I can't remember some.
Yeah.
I'm not sure where to go with that.
Yeah.
App you can't live without.
You got a good one for this? Shopify, we still use it, so we check that pretty regularly. You got anything better?
Best piece of advice you've ever received?
You know, aside from the usual sort of early sort of plugs to keep on going, there's a professor at Harvard Business School, Young Mi Moon, who's written a great book on innovation, and she talks about innovation sometimes being about taking stuff away. The assumption is it's always about adding new things, but the idea that innovation can actually be about stripping stuff away, and I think that's what we've done, and that's certainly the advice she gave to sort of double down on that instinct has been really powerful for us.
Thank you guys for your time, for your thoughts.
No worries.
We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having us. Thanks for having us. Amazing to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. appreciate it. Thank you.